had its beginning only yesterday in God's infinite time, so that there live today those who knew the dedicated and saintly Tar Heel Apostle, Father Henry Price. Father Price was the first North Carolinian ever to be ordained a Catholic priest. He devoted most of his life to the cause, his goal of making every Tar Heel a Catholic. And as he grew in wisdom and stature, he saw that the mission fields of North Carolina were only a part of the worldwide mission field. He understood God's infinite plan that all men should be one in the Church of Jesus Christ, and that it was not bounded by the winds and the tidewaters of North Carolina. And so, having lived a full life in the North Carolina apostolate, he became a co-founder of Maryknoll and a missionary to China. There he died, a martyr to his burning zeal. One of those he left behind to carry on the work of the apostolate in North with me now. I should like to introduce Monsignor William Francis O'Brien, who was Father Billy, or just Billy, to Father Price. Monsignor O'Brien is a link with the historic past. He was inspired by Father Price when he met him in 1888. He can see in the present a mirror of the heritage left us by Father Price. Now, Monsignor O'Brien, tell us, what do you see for North Carolina in the future?
Well, Father, I do not believe that God has given me the power of prophecy, but I may have been somewhat prophetic about what I wrote about Father Price after I had received a letter from him written in China 3 days before he died. I have it here in my memoirs. He's like an angel who goes before us to prepare our way. If our work in the past or in the future can be designated as apostolic, it is because it was and will be inseparable from his personal holiness of life and the spirit of the enduring reality of his labors, sensed around and about us. Father Price must have felt the divine urge when he climbed up the top of Mount Mitchell and spent the windswept night, and in the morning offered up the holy sacrifice of Mass for all North Carolina. He has built many churches and chapels, such as St. Mary's in Goldsboro, North Carolina, St. Paul's in Henderson, North Carolina, and the Church of the Holy Name of Jesus at Nazareth. Many churches have been built up around his churches. The beautiful Church of Our Lady of Grace in Greensboro, North Carolina, or the lovely modern church in our own city, Durham. Today's priests no longer have to cross through swamps and ride on cabooses and freight trains, like the accident that I had going around on my mission circuit. They will not have to be threatened with bodily harm or have doors closed in their faces on stormy nights. Well, Father, you and I know that the victory for the Church is far from being won in North Carolina. We are less than 1% of the Tar Heels. We are missionaries just as truly as the Maryknoller is in the Orient. I'm deeply grateful to God for sustaining me in life in this mission. First, as an associate of Father Price, and now as one of his successors. The Tar Heel Apostle is indeed like an angel who has gone before us to prepare our way.
by the original Tar Heel Apostle, Father Thomas Frederick Price, is a way of search, of witness, of courage, of perseverance, so that every North Carolinian will hear the truth and, knowing the truth, will fulfill Father Price's boundless desire that every Tar Heel be a Catholic. Today's apostles follow in the footsteps of Father Price by going into every town and place as did the disciples commissioned by our Lord. Today's priestly successors to Father Price marvel at how he was able to cover the 500 miles from the eastern tidelands and swamps to the rolling hills and mountains of the state's western boundaries, where beauty soars like a delicate mist across valleys which serve to deepen human isolation. There is as much opportunity today as there was in Father Price's time for priest, sister, and layman alike to carry on his crusade, to bring every North Carolinian into complete union with Christ and all the members of his body throughout the world. The apostolate seeks above all to win the young, because it is through them that future generations can live under the protecting arms of Christ's own church. For his apostolate, Father Price committed himself to the force of prayer, and today's missionaries kneel in the very chapel where he pleaded with his Blessed Mother, to whom he wrote a nightly letter, to help him become a martyr for her son. The Bishop of Raleigh intercedes with her too, that Christ will make zeal for the missions overflow into every North Carolina parish to spread the faith. In prayer, he has the unceasing help of Carmelite nuns, modern contemplatives who spend their lives begging God's help for a needy world. Here is astounding evidence of the power of prayer and apostolic works. This lovely church of Mary Immaculate in Durham. What a magnificent shrine to the Mother of God, patroness of the state and diocese. In many a growing parish, men of the Nocturnal Adoration Society pray in shifts a whole night through. What a difference their sacrifice can make. The campaign for souls is directed from the bishop's office in Raleigh. And there is a mighty task for the 200 priests among more than 4 million people who live in the Tar Heel State. The chancery is like an operation center, assuring business-like conduct of all priestly activities. The editor of the North Carolina Catholic and the director of the North Carolina Catholic Layman's Association use modern methods to spread truth throughout a missionary state. Recruits for the priesthood are still too few, but they are a select legion for Christ. They attend various seminaries throughout the country. During the summer, they live and work in the North Carolina mission field. The bishop inspires them with stories of victories already won. Of Dr. Monk of Newton Grove, who by his conversion became the Cornelius of the neighborhood to 1,500 subsequent Catholics. In that same vineyard in the heart of North Carolina lives one who was baptized and married by Father Price himself. She remembers when there were but 800 Catholics in all North Carolina. For many years, she has been sharing the fruits of her garden with her pastor. It might be be said that the North Carolina apostolate had its beginnings here at Old St. Thomas Church in Wilmington, where Father Price was baptized, educated, and ordained. His hands often held this old missal, for he was privileged to serve Mass for Bishop, later Cardinal Gibbons, when St. Thomas was the pro-cathedral for all of North Carolina. These boys who now serve at the altar where Father Price said Mass are proud, and their people are proud, to have inherited this historic church for their own parish. But a hill outside Raleigh was to become the center of Father Price's missionary efforts. The place, which he called Nazareth, was closest to his heart. Even before it was his apostolate headquarters, he had made it a haven for orphans, the first of whom arrived before the cupboard had been stocked with food. But God provided in time, as he does today, for the 100 orphans who are cared for here. In telling all this, the bishop reminds his seminarians that Father Price tried to build the first North Carolina apostolate with other dedicated young men. Father Price would have thanked his mother Mary could he have seen such a fine group of seminarians as this in his chapel every morning. He was not so fortunate. He imagined he had failed. Father Price's spirit is an inspiration to today's young seminarians who visit the Halifax Mission Chapel, which Father Price built and in which he often celebrated Mass, and the one-time Colonial Inn next door, where he was a guest. In the now unused sanctuary, the seminarians find a challenge in the faithful Nanny Gary. Why does she keep the chapel so immaculate? So that again someday, Catholics will here congregate at Mass. The seminarians discover that zeal is often kindled by adversity. What does a silver-haired priest feel after flames have destroyed his chapel? With God's help, we shall build again. Census taking is a lesson in the drudgery of the missions. Do Catholics live here? The seminarians learn how few there are. Sometimes, when a door is closed to them in enmity, they feel, as Father Price once said, the people here don't want me much. But they dare not give in to discouragement. Sometimes their reception is polite, but cool. But hardly a day passes without some reward, some victory for Christ, resulting possibly from a simple act of Southern hospitality. Is there more than hospitality in this woman's invitation to two hot and thirsty seminarians? Can there be a hunger for knowledge of the true Church of Christ? Maybe the answer can be found in the curiosity of the children. How much do they know about the Mother of God, their mother? Yes, here is hunger for God and His Church. Our Lady has opened the way for conversion. With Father Price, these seminarians can say, praise be to you, Mother, and to Jesus. At ordination, our Lord claims another tested child of God for his Tar Heel apostolate. The bishop prays in his heart, O Holy Ghost, ordain this soul as a priest of Christ, this first Negro ever to be so ordained in North Carolina. By this holy anointing, make these hands worthy to lift the body of Christ in daily sacrifice for the remission of our sins, and consecrate this priestly life to the missioner's goal of conversion, so that every soul in North Carolina may be united in the church which knows no boundaries, of mountains, or of tidelands, or of the stars, the true church which Christ founded on the rock of Peter. The young priest is still in awe of the great powers bestowed on him as he arrives at his first assignment. He held in the highest esteem because of the dignity of Christ's priesthood. Each new priest in North Carolina is assigned for 1 year to an apostolate center, as here at Newton Grove, where a thriving Catholic community grew from the conversion of Dr. Monk and the zeal of Father Price. The young priests are met by a priest director who will guide and advise them. Father is a stranger in his first mission. This is the rectory from which he will spread the love of Christ and the truth of his church. He is the first priest ever to live here. Is this poor dwelling place to be his home? Yes, but in time his parishioners will make it like a real home. Where shall he start with his work in the parish? Will a map help him decide? Well, no. Maybe it is better that he look over the first sermon he will preach to his new congregation tomorrow. There was that paragraph on the necessity of sacrifice. Will his people understand? He forgets the bleakness around him. The emptiness of the place takes flight with the echoes of his footsteps as he enters the quiet chapel and detects the faint odor of burned incense. He is not alone, for here is God. Father remembers the words which Father Price wrote in his nightly letter to his blessed mother. Help me, Mother, to be a saint. How better can a priest serve the souls of his parish? There is plenty of worldly work to do. A bill so soon, there goes tomorrow's collection already. He must introduce himself at the bank, where he must make payments on his parish's mortgage, and at the local newspaper, which he hopes will print news of his parish activities. His first Sunday Mass in this little chapel is crowded with Catholics curious to meet their first resident priest. They will accept him as their new ambassador from Christ, their intercessor with God. These are pious folk. And in their first sacrifice together with their new priest, there already is a bond between them, the bond of Christ and his members. This bond is certain to become more lasting through mutual kindness. One of the congregation has slipped back into the kitchen while the others were greeted by Father. Soon the aroma of coffee perking and of bacon and eggs was an invitation to a good breakfast for a hungry priest. Today also other newly ordained priests are meeting their parishioners. What a pleasure this can be. But for some, breakfast may have to wait until after two or even three masses. There are miles to travel from church to church, out along the roads of the tobacco country, to yet another congregation, waiting with shy, searching, even mischievous eyes. Soon discovers that there is a difference between the reserved greetings on his first Sunday and the welcome he receives when he gets to know his people. Could it be that Father has timed his visit to coincide with the serving of fried chicken? It doesn't take Father long to learn the habits of his parishioners. Father soon learns the occupations of the entire countryside. but he seems to have a special liking for chickens. In one day, he may move from the cackling at the chicken ranch to the silence of a radio studio, where he records a weekly sermon. By the time he returns to the Apostolate Center, the moon is shining down on a sleeping land. There is hardly enough time to relate experiences. The priest must help at the central parish too. Within weeks, it is time for the first monthly apostolate meeting, attended by young priests and their directors from the apostolate centers at North Wilkesboro, Charlotte, and Newton Grove. The bishop sees in this dream of Father Price an opportunity to encourage, admonish, instruct, and inspire the priests in training. There are mundane matters to discuss. Every penny must be well spent. But the most important matter is the care of souls. What have the priests to report? What are their problems? What are the rewards? Father has found adventure and God's work in the strawberry market. Here Father interrupts his priestly rounds to hear the staccato jargon of the auctioneer and watch the casual bidding of the buyers. One man has started attending Father's weekly instruction class. Father is teaching civic responsibility by participating in community affairs. Father performs his first wedding. What a joy to join with God in establishing a new Catholic family. Or at the end of life, to bring the strength of Christ to a departing soul. Father's greatest interest is in converts. Father prays that this woman will make as many converts as Dr. Monk. In this sparsely settled Catholic country, Father senses the hospitality of a Catholic woman who finds peace in Father's regular visits. This is Father's report to the apostolate meeting, where the bishop and his priests gather in the chapel for prayer and a pastoral talk by an experienced missioner. The Catholic motor chapel rolling into a remote non-Catholic community heralds another phase in the training of the young missionary priests. What would Father Price think of this modern version of the apostolic technique? No doubt he would approve of this humble work. And certainly, he would approve of bringing the view of the altar of God to the people of this small village. Father Price was a master in mission problems. He even established the magazine Truth to explain the faith to thousands. The priest begins with the sign of the cross, and after the prayer, he tells the basic truths of the Catholic faith. Who knows what soul Christ might touch by his words? What conversion to Christ's church might result? At the altar inside this church on wheels, the priest hopes his explanations will correct old misunderstandings. Far back in the mountains, tent meetings have been attractions for generations. And now, Catholic missioners have adopted this technique in isolated areas. After a time, there may be enough interest to justify a year-round chapel for mass and instructions. How often did Father Price wish for sisters to help him win souls through missions of mercy? This was his appeal in his New Year's Eve letter of 1909 to his Blessed Mother. Today, sisters go on many missions of mercy. The need to which they respond may be hidden deep in the mountains, or it may be in a city to be met by sisters administering the good works of Catholic charities. Sisters, once misunderstood by timid people, are now winning souls by the love shown for them in mountain town clinics or in the homes of the sick or in Catholic hospitals where modern miracles are performed. Kindness engenders such faith that young mothers often prefer that the most blessed event of all occur under the sisters' gentle care. Few would recognize this storefront as a Catholic church, but it is, made possible by a nucleus of converts after some years of effort. Once the parish is established, a priest lives among his flock. He knows that his every word and movement can win or lose these people to Christ. They must know that Father loves them, as Christ himself does. At last, they welcome him into their family circle. They respect him. They trust him. They learn that they can lay any problem before him, which could be brought to the feet of Christ. How can so few priests and sisters accomplish so much? They also enlist laymen as apostles. The priest director of the North Carolina Laymen's Association meets with sisters to plan missionary activities of dedicated Catholic men and women. These sisters and others like them make weekly sorties into every section of the state. First concern is the children. In the children's minds, they create a fascinating living image of Christ as they teach them the truths of Christian doctrine. Then they teach lay women to teach. Thus, many a Martha or Mary is added to the ranks of those who prepare the young in the knowledge of God and the church. And more Tar Heel children approach the day when they will receive spiritual nourishment in their first Holy Communion. Other children are made ready to receive the Holy Ghost in the sacrament of confirmation, to give evidence of the courageous faith within them. These members of the Universal Church, priests, sisters, and laymen, are thus contributing to the expanding partnership in Christ, not only in North Carolina, but everywhere in the world. The church in North Carolina is no longer the helpless infant it was in Father Price's day. Today, a priest is assisted by the laity, organized into the confraternity of Christian doctrine. Members of the confraternity board await their pastor in prayer until he arrives for their monthly meeting to plan parish activities. The sacrifice and zeal of this small group have helped to build this beautiful little church. This is a far cry from the $150 chapels built by Father Price. Every day, missions are growing into parishes, which are building solidly for the future. Is not this the royal priesthood of the laity, referred to by St. Peter and by many of our modern popes? The pastor sees the expression of the laity's zeal in many ways, and there is none more important than teaching. The laity in the Legion of Mary has two things in common with Father Price: consecration to Mary and a desire to share the faith with all North Carolina. A gravely sick boy knows the pleasure, and his mother knows the solace, which comes from a visit from the confraternity's parish visitors. A baby will benefit forever, because a parent educator committee helps mothers start the child's early Christian training. Here they all are, confraternity presidents and officers, teachers, fishers, helpers, discussion club leaders, parent educators, and their priests from all over the state. Wouldn't this have been a vision for the eyes of Father Price? In the North Carolina Layman's Convention, there are classroom demonstrations and workshops for every type of lay activity. Here, the Christian family is honored, too, with a special award for the Foster Parents of the Year, where, in all of Father Price's letters to his Heavenly Mother, was the thought of splendor such as this. Yet here are the fruits of his labors. Here are Catholics, converts and descendants of converts, and heirs of the early faithful, some wearing the uniform of the Catholic Daughters and the Knights of Columbus, all of them ambassadors of truth in North Carolina. Yes, Father Price, these are Tar Heel Catholics in convention for a solemn pontifical mass. You imagined that your apostolate had failed, but now it is succeeding. What more appropriate time for the bishop to honor the Mother of the Year? Are not these young people the Catholic parents and priests and sisters of tomorrow? The blessings of the Lord Jesus Christ be upon them, that someday every North Carolinian may be a Catholic. But there is formal education also. The children who board this bus every day, their priest driver, and the sister teachers are living evidences of the sacrifice and dedication required to provide an education in Catholic schools. Catholic boys and girls must be prepared for their destiny of sacrifice in a 99% non-Catholic state. Each year, more modern schools dedicated to education for Christ are being built to develop the whole Christian person, beginning at an early age, his intellect, his emotions, his will, so he can meet and influence life about him as a true Christian in his relations with God, the church, the state, his neighbor, nature, and himself. The curriculum is built around a Christian unity of purpose to accomplish the goals expounded in the encyclicals of the popes to form Christ in those regenerated by baptism. Belmont Abbey Church has built around it a component part of the Catholic education system in North Carolina. Here is the only Catholic degree-granting college for men in 8 southeastern states. Women may obtain degrees from the college too, but they enroll here only after graduation from Sacred Heart Junior College. Today, well above 12,000 pupils attend some 70 Catholic schools in North Carolina. But plans are still being made for greater growth, not only in elementary and secondary schools, but in the establishment of another North Carolina Catholic college. The apostolic spirit of Father Price is instilled in every Catholic youth. Here at a camporee, Catholic Boy Scouts live as missionaries by example, kneeling on this sanctified little island in a sea of non-Catholic brothers for all to see as they take into their bodies the grace that is imparted by the body of Christ. Girl Scouts and junior Catholic daughters also are recognized by the priest for their Christian contribution to their church and community. These young people find joy in attending a Catholic youth conference at the Catholic Assembly Grounds in the Blue Ridge Mountains. After attending Mass and prayer in the chapel, the pleasures of the swimming pool seem even more wholesome and invigorating. And when the hour comes for workshops, young minds set on fire by enthusiasm crackle in the give and take of spontaneous discussions on living their Christian ideals. There can be no end to the conditioning of Catholic youth. Summer campers live close to God at Our Lady of the Hills Camp, close to God in the tabernacle, as well as in the beauty of nature. The exciting camping program to which the boy has been running is forgotten as he stops for a chat with our Lord. He is an essential part of Christ's church on earth for the next generation. He will be an instrument for bringing Christ's universal triumph a generation closer. To 16 years of age, develop muscles and character in activities on and around the 50-acre Madonna Lake, 2,500 feet above the distant Atlantic. At evening, a whispered prayer of thanks goes up to God for all this beauty. Prayer is the soul of the North Carolina apostolate. Prayer that a Catholic North Carolina be united in the Church of Christ, which is everywhere in the world. Father Price prayed for this, and for an overpowering zeal for souls. The same zeal which today searches throughout the countryside and the streets and byways of every city for souls which must be claimed for Christ. The church builds and builds to serve the dynamic expansion of Catholicism in North Carolina. It achieves seemingly impossible goals through the sacrifices of local members who are supported by the prayers and the generosity of the Universal Church. Thus, in many a city and hamlet where a chapel once stood, a beautiful church now lifts its cross towards heaven. It beckons the people from the hills and the valleys and the tidelines. They will come as they learn the full truth, and they will build more and more chapels, which will become beautiful churches, in which they will praise God for bringing them to the true church of His Son, Jesus Christ, receiving His benediction as a renewed consecration to achieve the goal to which Father Price consecrated himself, that every Tar Heel will be a Catholic.